The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everybody. This is the second webinar of inDust. We have the pleasure today to host Mrs. Ourania Soupiona, and she's going to speak to us about the EARLINET observation during Saharan dust intrusions. Mrs. Ourania Soupiona is a member of the Laser Remote Sensing Unit of the National Technical University of Athens and working in the LiDAR field. She has recently defended her PhD thesis in November 2020 on studying aerosols in the Mediterranean basin using a synergy of LiDAR techniques and passive remote sensing methods. She has participated as a researcher in experimental research programs and campaigns. She holds two master's degrees, one in environmental physics and one from the National Ecopodistrian University of Athens and one from the School of Mathematical and Physical Sciences of the National Technical University of Athens. And she is currently an author or co-author of 10 peer-reviewed journal publications, and has participated in European and international peer review conferences with more than 15 publications, oral or poster. Mrs. Soupiona is going to present her recently published paper that was supported from inDust, and it's one of the chances that people that are involved in inDust that have to listen to these papers that are funded through our host action. Also, together with me is Sarah, who is the PI of the inDust host action. And Ourania, you can start your presentation.
Okay, great. So everyone can hear my, can see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. So thank you very much, Stelz, for the introduction.
Before starting, just to remind everybody, if it's the first time in these webinars, that everybody has a chance to ask questions to Ourania, and during the presentation, you can just write your questions in the question tab on your right in this webinar, go to webinar tool. Thank you, Ourania. Sorry. Yes, you can start.
Okay, great. So thank you very much. So today's presentation is about EARLINET observations of Saharan dust intrusions over the northern Mediterranean region, focusing on their properties and impact in radiative forcing. So as Telios already mentioned, it is a recently published paper in ACP, supported by the inDust cost action. Let's have a quick look at the outline. Actually, I will start to give you some information about aerosols and the Mediterranean basin, which is the studied area, then the instrumentation used for this study, and finally our results about aerosols properties and radiative effects. So, why aerosols are important? It is well known that their presence modifies the optical thickness of the atmosphere, affecting the radiative balance, changes cloud lifetime precipitation and albedo, is strongly dependent on atmospheric circulation, or even affects humans' lives. Especially mineral dust is considered a key component of Earth's climate system, since it is the most abundant component of atmospheric aerosol. Not only the magnitude, but also the sign of dust solar radiative forcing remains highly uncertain. Among others, some of the current scientific questions considering dust aerosols are what is the orientation of the dust particles, or why models miss most of the coarse dust, or how giant mineral dust particles can be long-range transported. So one way or another, dust is always in the foreground. Now, the Mediterranean region is usually mentioned as a region vulnerable to climate change. It plays a crucial role in different origin areas cross paths, since it covers portions of three continents, Europe, Africa, and Asia. The largest source of biosource in this area, as well as on a global scale, is the Saharan Desert. Meteorological conditions in the Mediterranean are affected by the South Asian summer monsoon through the monsoon desert teleconnection and the North Atlantic oscillation. And consequently, dust advections are modulated along rather regular seasonal patterns. In this area, we also have high evaporation, low precipitation, and remarkable solar activity. And the frequent long-range dust transport undergoes aging and mixing processes that may differ in the three major sub-areas, the Western, Central, and Eastern Mediterranean region. Of course, except dust, there are other types of aerosols, such as biomass burning, sea salt, anthropogenic, or even volcanic aerosols present. Concerning the instrumentation used in this study, special emphasis was given to the lighter measurements that have been performed in the frame of EARLINET within the period 2014 to 2017. Specifically, four EARLINET stations have been considered as representative of mineral dust events in the Northern Mediterranean due to their location close to the African continent. So from west to east, we have Granada, Potenza, Athens, and Limassol. For the first three stations, we have a common LiDAR setup of three packs scattered plus two extinction coefficients and one depolarization channel at 532 nanometers, while Limassol station is equipped with a polarization Raman LiDAR only at 532 nanometers. In order to provide homogeneous LiDAR data and results, we used this common study period, as I mentioned, and the vertical profiles of the 532 nanometers of backscatter, extinction, and depolarization signals. For the total set of dust events of each station, we considered for further analysis only the cases that met three basic criteria. The first one was the linear particle depolarization ratio to exceed 0.6 in the free troposphere. Also, the LiDAR ratio to range from 35 to 75 seradians in the free troposphere, and the thickness of the detected layer to be at least 500 meters. The critical height in which the first criterion was met was considered as the base of the layer, and this assumption was deemed necessary to be made since usually the lofted dust layers cannot be easily distinguished from the top of the atmospheric boundary layer, in which the presence of urban haze gives low depolarization values. Also, the top of the dust layer was estimated as the height where signals were similar to the molecular scattering in the free troposphere. Moreover, we performed a careful investigation of origin, of air mass origin and long-range dust transport by means of backward trajectory analysis per station, and we ended up with 51 cases in total. For these 51 cases, the mean values of optical and geometrical properties were calculated, and actually in this subplot, you can see the mean values of each dust layer by case by case, per station, and per year. And also, the horizontal boundary lines in each subplot represent the mean value of the whole period of each station, along with their standard deviation. So, in the first row, which depicts the geometrical properties, as you can see, Granada holds the minimum value for base and the maximum for top and layer thickness. For the linear particle depolarization ratio, we have mean values that range from 0.24 to 0.28. And for this parameter, Potenza holds the highest standard deviation. No remarkable deviations were observed for the parameter of the LiDAR ratio at 532 nanometers, since all stations have mean values of around 50 seradians, in good agreement with literature findings. Concerning the aerosolical thickness inside the dust layer at 552 nanometers, the largest values of this parameter are found over the station of Granada, in good agreement with the results of the first row. If we consider Granada station as representative for the Western Mediterranean region, Potenza for Central and Athens for Eastern Mediterranean region, a dust aerosol mode classification per region can be made. For this purpose, I have plotted the aerosol optical thickness at 532 nanometers versus the backscatter-related angstrom exponent value for the pair 532 to 1064 nanometers. A widespread of optical thickness values at moderate to low angstrom exponent values is observed over Western Mediterranean region, marked in red marks, which demonstrates that the size distribution over this area is dominated by the coarse mode of events of different intensities. On the other hand, the presence of dusty layers in the central and eastern Mediterranean region take higher angstrom exponent values, even up to 1.4, and consequently, the presence of fine mode particles are presented in this area with lower dust loads. Our findings verify that the longer the time and the distance of the transport is, the more likely it is for the dust aerosols to be mixed with background ones, especially in the Eastern Mediterranean region. So this scatter plot allowed us to perform a k-means clustering in order to define three physically interpretable clusters. And so we have the fine mode cluster in light blue, with angstrom exponent values greater than 0.6, the coarse mode cluster in magenta, with angstrom exponent values smaller than 0.6 and not small optical thickness values, and the yellow area here, which represents the extreme dust events, with angstrom exponent values small in general, and high optical thickness values greater than 0.2. As we can see, the majority of the extreme dust events occur over the Western Mediterranean region, probably due to its location closer to the African continent. And therefore, there are a lot of examples in literature that verify the presence of extreme dust events over the Iberian Peninsula. Now, based on the HSR classification provided by Gross et al. 2013, we plotted the LiDAR ratio at 532 nanometers versus the depolarization ratio, linear partial depolarization ratio at 532 nanometers. And we identified three of the six existing clusters in our data. At this point, I should mention that the small dots in the background are the measurements from the HSR classification, and our measurements are with the points and the error bars. So the first cluster that we identified is the one in green with green marks and error bars that represents a mixing state of Saharan dust and biomass burning aerosols. The second one with red marks and error bars is attributed to mixed Saharan dust, where dust aerosols are dominant, but other types of aerosols could be possibly present. And the third one, with orange marks and error bars, is attributed to pure Saharan dust, long range transported. Among these three clusters, the most populated and consequently the most common is the red one, as expected. And at this point, it is worth mentioning that the range of our measured linear particle depolarization ratio values indicated with the horizontal error bars overlap between the three identified clusters, showing a more realistic transition from one cluster to another and bridging the existing gap, especially between the green and the red clusters from the HSR classification. This table here summarizes the mean aerosol optical, geometrical and microphysical properties along with their standard deviation per cluster. And concerning the aerosol optical properties, the backscatter and extinction coefficients, as well as the aerosol optical thickness value within the dusty layer, take higher values for the Saharan dust cluster due to the higher dust burden of these events over the affected sites. No direct information can be extracted from a similar LiDAR ratio values at 532 nanometers. And however, for the cases where observations at 355 nanometers were available, we calculated the color ratio, which is the ratio of the LiDAR ratios, and we found that this ratio tends to unity as the mixing decreases. Also, the linear particle depolarization ratio increases as the mixing decreases, and we move to pure Saharan dust aerosols, and the axiom exponent value becomes smaller. Also, a synergistic approach of high split and Googlers allowed us to estimate the distance traveled to the representative sites and the mixing hours per cluster. Especially the mixing refers to the hours the trajectory traveled after leaving African continent. And as we can see, the Saharan dust cluster presents the lower mixing of this parameter among compared to the other two clusters, covering a greater distance at the same time. The main difference between the two remaining clusters is attributed to the mixing hours, since the air masses of the mixed Saharan dust cluster seem to remain of about 15 hours longer and circulate over Mediterranean and Europe, so they are probably enriched with other types of aerosols. The mean microphysical properties of all cases per cluster were also estimated with the Sphinx tool. And we should mention here that for the cluster with the presence of biomass-bearing aerosols, we found the minimum effective radius. For the two clusters that do not include biomass-bearing aerosols, the real and imaginary part of the refractive index was about the same, while for the cluster with the presence of biomass-bearing aerosols, we have higher values of the refractive index and smaller values of the single scattering albedo. And here, this visualization also verifies all the aforementioned information about the transport path and the possible mixing processes. Now, before moving to the results of the aerosol radiative forcing estimations, let me introduce you to the methodology applied for the simulations. First of all, we used Libratran, since it is a free online package that contains numerous tools to perform various aspects of atmospheric radiative transfer calculations. Its central program is UVSPEC, which calculates the radiation field in Earth's atmosphere. And UVSPEC includes various radiative transfer equation solvers as an input file, while the short wave and the long wave ranges are treated separately. Here, we used the short radiative transfer equation for mid-latitude conditions and the typical service albedo value for urban cities in the short wave range. Also, the opaque data set for the desert spheroids in the accumulation mode was considered, and actually OPAC stands for optical properties of aerosols and clouds. And concerning aerosols, it includes information about the aerosol extinction, scattering, absorption coefficients, the single scattering albedo, the phase function, the asymmetry parameter, and all this information is given in 61 wavelengths within the range 0.25 to 40 micrometers. As a final step, we used the vertical profiles of LiDAR data and DREAM dust mass concentration simulations as additional input. So actually, three different schemes were applied to create the input files for the dust loaded atmospheric conditions in Britain. Scheme A refers to the dust mass concentrations as estimated by DREAM dust model. In scheme B, only the dust vertical distribution was used as input based on the separation of the backscatter coefficient into the dust and non-dust components. That led to the calculation of the vertical distribution of the dust mass concentration. And in this way, we could determine the dust radiative portion. Also in scheme C, both contributions of dust and non-dust aerosols are taken into account, since the total extinction coefficient at 562 nanometers was used. All vertical profiles were degraded to the fixed heights of the opaque data set, and then a set of four simulations was carried out per case. The first two simulations refer to clear sky atmospheres with background aerosols, one for the short wave and one for the long wave range. And the two remaining simulations refer to the dust-loaded atmospheres, where we used the additional input, including the information of the dust layer vertically in the atmosphere. Again, one for the short wave and the long wave range. All cases were treated for cloud-free conditions, and except altitude, the outputs were the direct irradiance, the global irradiance, the diffuse downward and upward irradiances, and the heating rates. And finally, we can define the aerosol radiative forcing as the perturbation in flux in the atmosphere caused by the presence of the dusty layers in relation to that calculated in a clear atmosphere, in clear sky conditions. And these simple equations were applied to our retrievals to finally calculate the radiative forcing within the atmosphere, the bottom and the top of the atmosphere. Before also using the vertical dust mass concentration profiles retrieved from scheme A, from the model, from DREAM mass model in scheme A, and the LiDAR measurements as calculated from scheme B as inputs to the Libretan model, we performed the day-by-day comparison between them. So in this Taylor graph, the azimuthal angle represents the correlation coefficient, the radial distance represents the normalized standard deviation, and the black point mentioned as calculated indicates the LiDAR retrieved aerosol mass values, representing the reference point. So we observed that in the 66 of our cases, there is a good correlation and consequently a good prediction of the shape of the vertical distribution. However, in the majority of the cases, the model gives low concentration values since the normalized standard deviation is smaller than one, revealing an underestimation in the intensity and the mass concentration. But of course, we should take into account the spatial resolution, where the LiDAR observations are considered as point measurements, and the simulations of DREAM mass model represent uniform pixels of 0.3 degrees resolution. And of course, the temporal resolution, where the LiDAR profiles are hourly average, while the model estimations are instantaneous. By further comparing the model mass vertical profiles calculated by LiDAR and calculated by DREAM mass model, we report that the mean center of mass, as estimated from DREAM, is about 0.6 kilometers lower than the one calculated from LiDAR measurements. The maximum concentration is usually found in the region 2 to 3 kilometers, both in modeled and observed data. And the DREAM model, having a significantly lower vertical resolution compared to the LiDAR measurements, predicts smoother profiles of the dusty layers by spreading the layer space to lower altitudes and the top at higher altitudes in the majority of the cases. Now, concerning the results of the airborne radiative forcing, a negative forcing was found both at the bottom of the atmosphere and at the top of the atmosphere in the short wave rates for all three schemes, on average, of course, and the variations among these values are expected since this, the airborne radiative forcing strongly depends on the different airborne optical thickness values, the mass estimations, and the extinction profiles. Estimations from scheme B are expected to give higher values compared to scheme 1, taking into account the comparison I have just shown you. Also, the airborne radiative forcing in the long wave range, both at the bottom and at the top of the atmosphere, is opposite in sign and significantly lower compared to the short wave region in absolute value, of course. The difference between the top and the bottom of the atmosphere of the radiative forcing, with the top to be weakly perturbated and the bottom to be quite stronger perturbated, can be attributed to the heating within the troposphere, since the presence of dust aerosols mainly leads to a displace of the surface heating in the dust layer. So the net heating rate within the atmosphere, as you can see here, is clearly dependent on the solar zenith angle, and increases as the solar zenith angle increases. And this is because as the solar zenith angle increases, the optical path of the shortwave radiation grows significantly, generating a higher fraction of the diffuse radiation. And this effect is more pronounced at the bottom of the atmosphere, in which the intensity of the heating rate is reduced with increasing solar zenith angle. Here we report higher values for the all the solar zenith angles in scheme C compared to the other two schemes, even in small solar zenith angles, as you can see here, that it has a positive sign compared to the other two, of course, in mean values. In order to further explain this difference, we plotted the net heating rate of scheme C at the bottom of the atmosphere at 25 degrees of solar zenith angle of all cases, along with the base layer height, the aerosol optical thickness, and the layer's thickness. It becomes clear that the sign of the net heating rate at the bottom of the atmosphere depends strongly on the dust vertical structure and the aerosol optical thickness. More precisely, the majority of the cases having low optical thickness values and low layers thickness give negative net heating rate values at the surface. Concerning the base layer height, it plays a key role to the absolute net heating rates. Since dust layers closer to the ground take higher absolute net heating rate values, and in general, a combination of high optical thickness values, high layer thickness, and low base height give high positive net heating rate values, which in our case range from 0.06 to 0.26 Kelvin per day. And again, the airborne radiative forcing seems to be inversely proportional to the mixing ratio, since higher absolute values are estimated for the less mixed dust layers of all schemes. And this can be explained by the fact that the aerosol radiative forcing is strongly dependent on the extinction, backscatter, and aerosol optical thickness values that take much higher values of the Saharan cluster, as already mentioned. To up to 10 kilometers high in the free troposphere, as estimated for CMC at 45 degrees in the shortwave range per station. As we can see, the aerosol radiative forcing profiles at the right hand of its subplot follow the structure of the extinction profiles vertically in the atmosphere. They take high absolute values, the highest absolute values at the surface, and decrease in with increasing heights, having a cooling behavior. And among these four stations, the highest cooling effect is observed over Granada, since, as we already mentioned, in Granada we observed the majority of the extreme dust cases during the period 2014 to 2017. So, to sum up, we performed an analysis in regional coverage with ground-based instruments, and this is very important because it is not very usual to have simultaneously the vertical information and the regional coverage. We can conclude concerning the optical properties that long-range transported dust is, of course, always a mixture of various elements, where intensity and abundance designate the aerosol optical and microphysical properties. A combination of one can check the mixing ratio by taking a combination of the linear pathic depolarization values, the optical thickness, and the layer's thickness. And concerning the radiative forcing, the vertical structure, the base thickness, and intensity are critically important in simulating the aerosol radiative effect. And in modeling the radiative forcing, vertical profiles of backscatter and extinction could be basic input parameters in order to give the information about the vertical structure of the atmosphere. And of course, the radiative forcing is more sensitive in the shortwave range and especially at the bottom of the atmosphere, where concerning dust aerosol, it has a cooling effect. I would like to take also a moment to thank again the inDust Cost Action for supporting this publication. And of course, many thanks to all the co-authors for their help, contribution, and support in order of this study to be completed and published. And here are some references I have mentioned in the presentation. And that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the very good presentation. We can continue with some questions that exist in the chat. I don't know if Sarah, you want to mention them or?
I answer one of the questions that someone was asking us about the presentations. If you go to the website, in that website, you will find the recording of all the webinars after a few days of the event. We are preparing now a new section in the website, but if you go to the event of Ourania, after a few days, the registration will replace the recording, then it will be accessible. And for the presentation, I don't know if Ourania wants to share with the audience, but in any case, the results are in this publication that you mentioned. As you prefer.
The presentation, of course, could be published, but it includes all the results that refer to the paper. So one can just go straight to the paper in ACP 2020, so he can find anything in this publication.
Okay.
Then Aksat Gul Yilmaz, I don't know if I pronounced correctly your name, but you can contact directly Ourania if you are interested in the PowerPoint.
Okay.
pleasure. There is another question about the slide number nine. I think that is related with the backtrack here. And Zainab Salat is asking you, how can you calculate the distance and hours of the gas transport?
Using high speed gives information every 6 hours. So if you plot high speed trajectories on a Google Earth map, or you can download the TXT from high speed and you can calculate the distance. As I mentioned in this work, the mixing hours refer to the trajectories traveled after leaving African continent. So you can point the start and then start measuring the time traveled. And the distance by using a distance calculator tool of Google Earth. It's that simple.
Okay. There is another question about the higher dust particle diameters for Alexandros Papagiannis. And he asks if you are going to use some other macrophysical code in order to have higher dust particle diameters. If this code exists. Looking at your presentations, I think that you used the opaque and
yes, concerning radiative forcing calculations, I used the opaque dataset and it includes a radius from for desert spheroids in the accumulation mode, where accumulation mode is defined in this region here, from almost 0 to 20 micrometers.
Yes. Okay. Then Sofia Gomez Macueo asks if you can explain a little bit more how, in which way are the pure Saharan dust and the mixtures are defined. And if it is based on trajectories or in the LiDAR ratio.
Can you repeat it, please?
Yes. The question is, if in the end you define the pure dust from the mixtures based on the back trajectories or based on the LiDAR ratio and the angstrom exponent ratio?
The answer is a combination of all these parameters. We used, of course, the threshold values, let's say, from the depolarization and the LiDAR ratio. But of course, we also took into account not only the high speed backward trajectories, but the most information about fires. Yes, especially a combination of all this led to the mixing. And of course, the HSR classification by Gross et al. Was the one that gave information about the thresholds I mentioned concerning the depolarization and the LiDAR ratio.
Yes. Okay, another question is if you can identify the different kinds of minerals by EARLINET or not.
I think this needs a chemical analysis, which it's not easy to be done in the free troposphere. So we cannot say the chemical composition of mineral dust, if I understood correctly the question.
Yeah. Okay, it's a kind of a general one, but yeah. Well, another. Yeah. Another question is like a comment is that you mentioned that the majority of your cases are mixed dust. And the question is why the depolarization ratio decreased toward 0.28 in your presentation. Probably
I'm not sure if I understood correctly, but concerning mixing, the depolarization is shown here, if you still can see my screen.
Yes.
So, for mixing, for the mixed Saharan dust, it takes a mean value of around 0.26 compared to the other cluster that is much higher.
Yes. Yes, okay, this is clear from the table. Then another question
I think that is the same question than before from Zainat Zela, that is again wondering about the method that you use for calculating the hours of the transport through the observational point.
Google Earth distance calculator.
Yes, we have the coordinates for every 6 hours, and then you put this in the Google, and you can calculate for this 6 hours how much is the distance. I think that's it, isn't it?
Yes, exactly.
Just for the information of the net, the back trajectories of high split are accessible through a website of Anchor, or you can calculate through a support. Then just check high split and you will get all the information that I think that you need. Okay. Go ahead, Elias, go ahead.
Yes. Now, I'll say something about the question that I understand more. A possible solution would be to run the isoropia thermodynamical model to get an idea of the chemical composition of dust particles. It's just a comment on your question about the minerals.
Yes, it's a good idea to further explore the mixing by using isoropia. Yes.
Yes. Now there is another question based I will read it. Is there connected interpretation by pandemic period and the air affected to being put dust? How dynamically we can use this in the study knowledge? So I guess your work here is not really, it's not linked with the pandemic. It's just
no, I have included data from 2014 to 2017. I have not current data from 2020.
Okay.
But we can. There was a dust event this May during COVID quarantine, and there is a paper that we are working on now, and will be hopefully shortly published.
Okay. So right now I don't see any other legit questions. So I have also one question about your slide 15. So, yeah, if I understand correctly, your radiation profiles are directly, let's say, calculated from the extinction profiles that you saw here, because you are in this case C or sim C, as you mentioned.
Yes.
And the question is, for example, I don't understand a little bit the fact that for Larnaca, have some very, let's say, high extinction files, which if you integrate this will give very high AOD. For example, these profiles on the right.
Yes.
And then on the Granada, we have much lower ones. But in the end, you see that the ARF, as you calculate, it's much higher in Granada than in Larnaca. So that's my question.
Yes, indeed. But actually, also in Granada, the top of the layer is higher. So in general, maybe the optical thickness is higher here than here. And also, one thing that I should mention is that lighter measurements have the overlap effect, and so we cannot be sure about the value of the extinction at the ground level. And for this reason, we assumed that the first measurement that is valuable is the same at the bottom. So this is an assumption here, and this could lead to some errors. But in general, the answer is that the layer thickness is important, and the base of the layer is also important. That can give higher radiative forcing values in absolute values.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think there are no other questions. And I don't know, Sarah, if you want to ask something or.
I am trying to understand one of the participants that is asking us something. But I have to say that I'm not really sure about the question that she's trying to ask you, because it is connected with the question about the pandemic, but I am not really sure. Then I'm waiting. I mean, the lawyers and the distribution. She is Aksa Gül from Turkey. And she wants to ask you about the layers and the distribution of the effect of this income, how we can connect to
Personally, I don't understand the question, so it's probably not to forward it, because if we cannot understand it, then Ourania probably also will not understand it. So it's not clear.
She's asking you. No, I understand now the question. Now she's asking you about how the distribution of the vertical layers that you found for dust before the pandemic can change a little bit in the, if the transport of dust somehow will change because the pandemic's effect, let's say, the lockdown effect.
Yes, actually, this is
thank you.
More a theoretical question, and it's not exactly based on this presentation, but one answer I can give is that if the local pollutants are reduced due to the pandemic and the quarantine and all this situation, probably the mixing, especially in the lower troposphere, of course, let's say inside and a few meters above the PPL, the mixing could be less, hypothetically speaking. If take into account that the pollutants are reduced and the urban aerosols and emissions are reduced, probably the mixing will be reduced, but especially in the lower altitudes.
I think that now she's happier with your answer, because she's saying thank you. And as regards from Turkey, then I think that we get the final answer to her. And yeah, I don't know if anything seeing anyone wants to write the last question or a comment or some discussion. We have 10 minutes before the end of the webinar. Then I have to say that you were super fast in your talk. We were thinking that you take a little bit more of time than it's time for questions. And if you don't have more questions for Ourania, I will take the benefit of these few minutes just to announce the next webinars.
I would like to mention again that anyone can find this publication online in ACP, Soupiona et al. 2020. So feel free to download it and share it with your colleagues and answer many of the questions that probably arise during this presentation.
Okay, thank you very much, Ourania.
Thank you very much.
And Sarah is going to probably present now the next two webinars.
Yeah, here we have the first webinar in February. It will be in charge of Aurelio Tobias from the Spanish Council for Scientific Research in Spain. And the talk will focus in short-term health effects of desert dust. This is like an overview of a One World Health Organization technical report that he coordinates together with Massimo Stoppati. And I think that Aurelio is in the audience today, then I don't know if you want to say something about the webinar. You can put something in the chat if you want to express something else about the webinar that is coming in 2 weeks. And also the second webinar of February, it will be in charge of Isadora Jimenez. She is our communication expert in inDust. In fact, she is the coordinator of science communication of the COST Action. And she is an expert in communication. And on 24th, she will talk about data visualization in user-favorite products and give us some examples on how the information that we are producing doing research can be also connected with some socioeconomic sectors. I think that she will include an example of clean energy, for example. And I think that it's quite interesting to also attend to this webinar because it's another perspective of how we can connect research with users. And don't forget that all the webinars until April are available in the inDust website. Then you can register. And yeah, if you have any proposals for the upcoming webinars, if you have in mind someone, you can also contact Estelios and me just for the proposal. And we will try to allocate the talk in the next month. You keep in mind that our intention is to have one webinar every 2 weeks. But if we think that there is a special situation where we can allocate one extra webinar, we are open to also rearrange the schedule. Okay? Then don't hesitate to contact us. You have all contacts. And this is everything from my side, Estelios. I think that no more comments at the moment.
Okay. So thank you very much for being with us today in this webinar, and we also will be happy to see you in 2 weeks.
Have a nice Wednesday.
Yes. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.